I was in LA doing back to start shooting Paul, and I got word that John wanted to meet up, and I'd met him before when we did our Spaced promo over there. He'd come to the screening of Spaced at the ArcLight, and I heard he said, "Do you want to go out for?" He says, "Like, do you want to go out for dinner and a movie?" And I was like, "Okay, I'm going to go on a date with John Landis," and we went to see Terminator Salvation at the DGA, which was great fun to watch. With him was hilarious. And then we went to have dinner together, and we had a big long chat. And I was kind of sitting there thinking, this is nice, you know, we got on when we met, so it's nice to be hanging out. And then he said, "Oh, I'm going to do a movie in the UK next year. Do you want to be involved?" And I'd actually read the script and liked it. And it was kind of in a pile of stuff that I, after I'd finished with my stuff, you know, I could look at. And as soon as I heard John was doing it, I was like, oh, yes, sign me up. Definitely.
Deal be it.
Yeah.
Obviously, Ronnie Corbett's also involved. Yeah. Was that surreal? Did he keep cracking jokes?
No, well, the thing is, I was really happy when I heard he was in it, because I think the thing that's always been at the heart of their comedy when he was working with Ronnie Barker was that they very much were actors. You know, I mean, a lot of the best stuff in the two Ronnies, their serializations like Charlie Farley and Piggy Malone and the Phantom Raspberry Blur, they'd always play very seriously. In that respect, I thought they were kind of the progenitors to the sort of the later contemporary naturalistic comedy that we see, when people are actually playing it straight and the humor's coming from something else, you know. And I always thought Ronnie Corbett was a great actor, but he's never given the opportunity to show that. I think he was in Fierce Creatures, but that's still very much a comedy. But he was in, he did like No Sex Please with British. So his film career, though, was never huge because he was a big TV star. But he's a talented actor, and to see him in this made sense. You know, he's Scottish for stars. He's playing a little bastard called Tam McClintock, who's a real little shit. And he was brilliant. Hard to keep a straight face, though, because sure. His eyebrows are alone gonna act me a long way.
You mentioned Scottish here, so you've done a Scottish accent in Star Trek,
yeah,
and you're doing Northern Irish here.
Yeah.
Are you looking for a Welsh project?
I am looking. I was saying to someone else, I want to do Cardiff the movie. God. Maybe Aberystwyth the movie. It was actually unnerving when Chris Hewitt from Empire came on set, because he's a Northern Irishman, and I was very aware of him listening. Because you know you want to get it right, basically, and accents are always an easy thing to sort of like criticize if you don't get them exactly right, and it's a tough one. It's a very elaborate and gymnastic language, Northern Irish. It's lyrical, and there's as much to do with the intonation as there is to do with the sound of the words. And for me and Andy both, it was, you know, we were constantly going over it and over it in our heads. It was tough.
Were you disappointed that this movie wasn't in 3D?
Yes, absolutely. Everything should be in 3D now.
Good. I'm glad Sony had the balls to say it. Any news on Mission Impossible 4?
Only because you can charge more. That's why all this 3D nonsense is happening.
Really?
Yeah, it's because you can charge more for the seats. Anything that suddenly becomes 3D, mm-hmm, when it wasn't 3D when it was shot, mm-hmm, mentioning no names, is because they go, hey, hang on, we can charge more for tickets.
Well, I just thought, you know, obviously grave robbing, 3D.
3D grave robbing. Well, actually, they weren't grave robbers. This is one. If you interview John Landis, he'll scream at you for saying that. So I'll just give you a pre-warning. They tried grave robbing, but it didn't work out because the bodies weren't fresh enough, which is why they started doing what they did. Mm. I can't say anything about Mission Impossible 4.
And finally, if you could start any rumour about yourself, because a lot circle around, obviously, in the movies,
yeah,
what would it be?
All of my lead actresses fancy me. I work with so many nice ones, it would be so cool. But, the funny thing is that usually, if I say something, then it comes true. Like with the Mission Impossible 3 thing, I once said that I wasn't going to just go off and be in that. And that didn't even exist when I said that. It was like I plucked it out of the air. And then the Romero thing as well, being in Land of the Dead, was like a rumor that we started. Me and Nick tried to start a rumor, I think when we were doing Hot Fuzz, that we were going to be starring in, and we said there's going to be a live action version of Danger Mouse with me as Danger Mouse and Nick as Penfold. And within 3 days, it came back to us in a situation. So, is it true that you're going to be doing this? So, I'm wary with rumours.
You're teasing me because I would kill kittens to see that movie. Absolutely.
And there was a time when we were going to, like, there was going to be a new cartoon that Nick and I were going to, we got asked as a result of that rumour, mm-hmm, but it never happened.